I won't be before you long. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I do thank God for this day. Amen. Hallelujah. Not just because it's Mother Day, but I thank Him for being a mother. But I thank Him also because this is a new day I've never seen before. I've never experienced this day before. Nor will I ever experience it again. So it's a great day. It's a great day to be alive in Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. So we're going to move on. Hallelujah. We're going to move on in the Word. Amen. I thank God for all of you. I thank God for my husband, for my pastor, Apostle Jenkins. Amen. Let's give it up for him. Hallelujah. I thank God for all our leaders. I thank God for all of you. And I thank God for being God. Amen. 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 So we're gonna move on. Hallelujah. We're gonna be in the book of Judges. The book of Judges. And our topic is rise up. Will you say with me, rise up?
Rise up.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, have your way, God. Have your way, Jesus. Have your way. Have your way. Hallelujah. So first I'm gonna start with the book of Judges and how it got its name. The book of Judges takes its name from the gifted leaders who guided Israel from the death of Joshua to the days of Samuel. Samuel was Israel's last judge. The leaders were raised up by God to deliver his people from oppression. The people would have peace in the land. Now this is the cycle of it in the book of Judges. God would raise up a leader. The people would have peace. But when that leader would die, the people would revert back to their old ways. And in that land, there were idols, there were false gods, there were wickedness, and the people would revert back to their own ways. And then God is a merciful God. The people would cry out to God. Cry out because they were oppressed. They were tired of being oppressed. They would cry out to God. And our God is a merciful God. He heard his people. He would raise up a leader. And the people would be free from bondage. And then the cycle would continue again. The leader would die. The people would revert back to the old. The people would get into bondage because they reverted to the old, and they would get tired of the oppression. They would cry out again to God. He would raise up another leader. This would continue. The book of Judges covers 300 years. So it's from the time of the first judge to Samuel. 300 years. So now we're going to go to... Let's go to verse 1. And the children of Israel again did evil in the sight of the Lord when Ehud was dead. That was another judge that God raised up. And the Lord sold them into the hand of Jabin, king of Canaan, that reigned in Hazor, the captain of whose host was Sisera, which dwelt in Harosheth of the Gentiles. And the children of Israel cried unto the Lord, for he had 900 chariots of iron. In 20 years, he mightily oppressed the children of Israel. So Sisera was the captain, and he had a fierce army. They consist of 900 chariots of iron. And the people were oppressed. So, again, they cried out to the Lord. You can be seated if you want to. Hallelujah. Jesus, we thank you for your word. So now we're going to go to verse 4, because now we're going into verse 4, and we're going to talk about Prophetess Deborah. So the people at this time are oppressed, depressed. They're tired of being in bondage. Once again, they cried out to the Lord, and once again, God heard them and raised up a leader, raised up a deliverer. Now, verse 4, and Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lapidoth, she judged Israel at that time. And verse 5, and she dwelt under the palm tree of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in Mount Ephraim. And the children of Israel came up to her for judgment. So we know Deborah was a prophetess. She was a wife. She was a judge. Now we know a prophet is God's mouthpiece, right? Amen? So we know Prophetess Deborah was speaking the things that God wanted her to speak. She was saying what thus say the Lord. She was also a wife, and she was the fourth judge of Israel. Now, what a judge did at that time, they administered sound counsel and settled disputes for the children of Israel. They administered sound counsel and settled disputes for the children of Israel. Now, keep in mind now, not only was she a judge, she was a prophetess. So I believe, knowing that she was a prophetess, she was a leader of God. She was God's mouthpiece. So she just wasn't speaking on her own accord when other people came to her. When she counseled the people, when she guided the people, it was God speaking to the people. Now, there are some things we need to know about her. I believe she was a prayer warrior. She was a woman that spent time with God. She honored and she was just thankful to be in the presence of God. So she prayed. She spent time with God. She listened to the voice of God and just didn't move on her own accord. Now, she settled disputes among the people. So the people would come to her and she would tell them the righteous thing to do or the right way to go. Now, not only that, but let's take it to 4 and 5. It says, she sat underneath a palm tree. This was a special kind of tree, y'all. It wasn't just any kind of tree. There was a special name for this palm tree. And that palm tree represented righteousness. That palm tree represented wisdom. She sat under that palm tree. She dwelt under that palm tree. She didn't just go there when she thought the people was coming so that she could provide wise counsel. She dwelt there. She dwelt there. She spent her time there under that palm tree, that tree of righteousness, under that tree of wisdom. And not only that, but it says Ramah. And she dwelt under the palm tree of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel. Now, Ramah represents a high place. It was a spiritual place. Everything that's spiritual don't mean it's godly. We got to recognize the difference, y'all. Ramah was a high place. Deborah was between Ramah and Bethel. The high place. The place that represents idolatry. The place that represented wickedness, the place that represented the flesh, really, that kept the people in bondage. So we got Deborah here, and we got Bethel here, the house of God here. So she was between these two places. Now, I don't think that she was there just to be there. She was not there just to be there. We got to recognize those high places. In our life, those high places in our life, those things that come up against us, come up against our mind to separate. separate us from God. Those things that try to influence us. Those things that appeal to the flesh. We got to recognize those things. Those are high places. But then the house of God, the house of Bethel. So, you know, and I do believe this represents, God gives every last one of us a choice to make. We have wickedness here. We have God here, the house of Bethel. And we're in between. Who are you going to choose? What decisions are you going to make? The enemy is going to present himself. He's going to present the lust of our flesh, pride of life, the lust of our eyes. He's going to present that. He's going to present people our way to influence us, to try to persuade us to not dwell in the house of God and not let the Spirit of the Lord dwell in us, but to come over here to this high place. And this high place here, this place of wickedness, this place of discord, it might feel good at the time. Because it feels good. Wickedness, sin feels good to the flesh. But it's only a temporary satisfaction. But what God gives us is eternal satisfaction, eternal contentment in Him. So we got to recognize those high places in our minds, those high places in our heart that try to get us to dwell into those places of idolatry, those places of sin, instead of the place that God wants us to be. I'm talking about a spiritual place now. It's easy for us to think of a physical place. It's easy for us to come to church. But I'm talking about when you leave this building, where you dwell in. What is your mind on? Is it on foolishness? Is it on idolatry? Are you putting something in the place of where God should be? Where is your mind dwelling? What do you have your mind on? It ain't what we do here. It's what we do when we leave here, people. We gotta know that Bethel, the house of God, is with us wherever we go, if we believe that. Because the Holy Ghost dwells in us. We're a place of righteousness because God's Spirit dwells in us. We have to know that. So we got Ramah, we got Bethel, and Deborah is dwelling in between those two places. One thing about it, she got her mind made up. She's not. The Bible says, be hot cold. She's dwelling with God. She has her mind made up in Jesus. She's a praying woman. She's a fasting woman. Now, I'm not saying we're not going to have our challenges, because all of us got our challenges. But what I am saying is, don't use it as an excuse to sin. I am saying it. You know what your weaknesses are. Don't continue to promote that weakness. Don't continue to promote that weakness. How do we promote our weaknesses? Saying, always speaking doubt, always speaking fear. I can't do this. I can't do that. I don't have the strength to do this. I don't have the strength to do that. I don't have strength to say no to that man. I gotta say yes to that man. That man ain't your husband. Yes, you got the strength to say no.
Amen.
I don't have the strength to put down those drugs. I gotta smoke that blunt. You got strength. You're just making an excuse, and you don't want to put that thing down. How can God mightily use you if you're putting up excuses? We got to have our mind made up. We have to have our mind made up. Hey, I'm gonna dwell in Bethel. I'm going to let Bethel dwell in me because I'm a child of God. Ephraim. And it says, and she dwelt under the palm tree of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in Mount Ephraim. Ephraim means fruitfulness. She dwelt between Ramah and Bethel in Mount Ephraim. And the children of Israel came up to her for judgment. Don't you know if she wasn't? And then, I know I'm talking about a woman. However, the word is the word, and it applies to you too. One thing about it, the word has no respect for persons. Don't you know, Deborah was the fourth judge, and she was a woman. That lets us know God has no respect for persons. Word is the word, and where the word hits you, that means you need to change in that area. That means, Lord, help me to change. Help me to change, Lord. So, as I said, Ephraim meant a place of fruitfulness. Oh my God, listen, y'all, we cannot be fruitful if we're looking for the world to be our solution. Yeah, you're going to yield a temporary crop. But what God has for us is eternal. Not just now. I want to be fruitful now. Not only do I want to be fruitful, I want to dwell in the house of the Lord. I want my family to dwell in the house of the Lord. I want you to dwell in the house of the Lord. Whatever I'm connected to, I want them to dwell in the house of the Lord. Because in the house of the Lord, there's fruitfulness. And I ain't talking about this physical building. I'm talking about this temple here. I'm talking about this temple here. Everything, hey, I'm connected to. I want it to be fruitful. I know it will be fruitful if I continue to have faith, if I continue to believe, if I continue to be steadfast and firm in the word. I'm not going to let nothing cause me to move. I'm not going to be immovable. I'm going to plant myself in the word of God because he's my refuge. He's my strength. And I'm going to be fruitful because my God is fruitful. Amen? So I'm going to move on. I'm going to move on. So now, in another way we can be fruitful. Y'all, we got to seek out the wisdom of God. We got to seek out his wisdom. Seek it out and you will find him. Proverbs 2 and 6. The Lord giveth wisdom. And out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. We cannot rely on our own intelligence. We can't rely on our own knowledge. It's limited. It's only going to get us to a certain point. But we got to rely on the wisdom of God. His wisdom sustains us. His wisdom establishes us. Not only our house, but our loved one's house. We can't forget his wisdom. The word says, get wisdom. Get understanding. Get wisdom. Get understanding. So many times we're just so quick. We hear a word and we're ready to move. We got to meditate on that word. We have to study to show ourselves approved, rightly dividing the word of truth. And we have to let that word saturate us, get inside of all of us. Get inside my heart. Meditate on it day and night. Day and night. Because that word is wisdom. God will speak revelations to your heart. When you meditate on his word, he will speak to your heart. He will give you keys to unlock your life. That's what wisdom does. It unlocks. That's why he said, seek wisdom. When you lose your key, what are you going to do? You go look for your key. You turn everything, the house upside down to find those keys. Why are we turning things upside down to find God's wisdom? Amen. Discovering his word, the wisdom of his word, looking everywhere. God, God, I need an answer for the solution. God, God, I need your wisdom. I want to make sure that I'm not moving according to my own understanding or my own ability, but I want to move in your wisdom. When we move according to the wisdom of God, he establishes us. He gives us a plan. He gives us a strategy. He establishes us. And we got to move by faith, saith the Lord. You're not going to understand everything. It's not going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in that order. God gives you pieces of it. And you apply And as you apply your faith, things start to manifest. And then he gives you some more. And you apply your faith. He's giving you strategy. He gave Prophetess Deborah a strategy. And I am going to move on. Let's see here. So verse 6 says, and she sent and called Balak, the son of Abinon, out of Kadesh Naphtali, and said unto him, hath not the Lord God of Israel commanded, saying, go and draw toward Mount Tabor, and take with thee 10,000 men of the children of Naphtali, and of the children of Zebulun. Verse 7, and I will draw unto thee to the river of Kishon, Sisera, the captain of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his multitude, and I will deliver him into thy hand. Into thy hand. Not only, see, in verse 6, Prophetess Deborah, she was using her prophetic manual and mantle, and she was telling Barak what the Lord spoke to her. Now, God is using her. God is using her. She's saying the words, but this is the work of God at hand. He's telling her, speaking through her, to let Barak know what to do, how to move. So we're going to read further. So verse 7 says, and I will draw unto thee to the river of Kishon, Sisera, the captain of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his multitude, and I will deliver him into thy hand. Verse 8, and Barak said unto her, if thou wilt go with me, then I will go. But if thou wilt not go with me, then I will not go. Verse 9, and she said, I will surely go with thee, notwithstanding the journey that thou takest shall not be thy honor. For the Lord shall sell Sisera into the hand of a woman. And Deborah arose and went with Barak to Kadesh. So we have Prophetess Deborah telling Barak what to do, basically saying what God had told her to speak. And not only that, but God spoke through Deborah to let Barak know that he was going to win, that he was going to be successful, that he was going to deliver him into thy hand. And Barak says something odd. He said unto her, if thou will go with me, then will I go. But if thou will not go with me, then I will not go. Don't you know? Because of Deborah's position, because of her posture, not only did the Israelites listen and took heed to the word, because they know she was speaking and God was speaking through her, but Barak did also. He knew this was a woman of God. He knew God was with her. And he says, I don't want to go into war without you, because I don't want it to just be me. I want to know the hand of the Lord is with me. I know God is with you. I know God speaks through you. I know you got a praying life. I know you got a fasting life. I know you know the Lord. And because you're telling me to go, I'm going to go. I'm going to be obedient. But I want you to go with me. How many of you know, if God didn't tell you to do it, you better not do it. If God tells you to do it, you better do it. And have enough sense to know that I'm not doing this on my own. I'm doing this because God is with me. Obedience means something. Obedience means something. I didn't read here when Barak, because he was one of the generals. I look at him as a general. He was over the army. I didn't read anywhere where he hesitated. I didn't read anywhere where he doubted. But I did read, he says, I'm going to do this, but I want you to go with me. That didn't mean he hesitated. That didn't mean he doubted. When God tells us to do something, God used men, women of God. God used his leaders. God uses you. Because God instructs you to tell folks to do certain things. Not only that, God will tell you to do a certain thing. Are you going to doubt him, or are you going to be obedient to him? I didn't hear any hesitation in reading this from Barak. He just wanted to know that the Lord was with him. He wanted to know that the Lord is on his side, on his side. Now they're about to go into war. The people they're about to war against is, they have chariots of iron. It's a large army. It's a big army. Now, he has 10,000 men of the children of Naphtali. He has 10,000 people. But this other army they're about to war against, they have more people. They have those chariots of iron. When you look at them, you would wonder, why are these people going up against this big army, this large army with a lot of technology, where it looks like they're going to win? Why would these small group of people go up against this large army? Oh, they're committing death. It looks like the table's stacked against them. It looks like there's no way they're going to come out alive. They must be crazy. People are looking at you and saying, why is she still believing God? Why is she doing this? Why is she doing that? Why is she still going to church? When it looks like things are stacked up against her, when it looks like God isn't working for her, when it looks like God isn't on her side, when it looks like there's all kind of chaos in this life, when it looks like children are acting up and acting crazy, all that going on, why are you going to the house of the Lord? All this going on, this big army here, why are you trying to come up against this big army? Because God says so. That's why. Because God told me to do so. And not only did God tell me to do so, he already confirmed my victory. God has already confirmed your victory through Jesus Christ. He has confirmed your victory. God gave them a strategy. God gave them a plan. And they worked the strategy and they worked the plan. And God says, I am with you. I am with you. And I will deliver them into your hands. So we're going to go a little further here. Verse 9 says, and she said, I will surely go with thee, notwithstanding the journey that thou takest. So Deborah is saying, I'm going with you. I'm not going to leave you hanging, Barak. I'm going with you. Not be for thy honor, for the Lord shall sell Sisera into the hand of a woman. And Deborah arose and went with Barak to Kadesh. Now, we got to be careful, y'all. We got to be careful. Because you know what? We are at war. Believe it, this ain't peace time. In the spirit, this is not peace time. Don't get it twisted. Why do you think chaos is going on here? Don't get comfortable in the chaos. God is preparing his people. He's preparing you. Don't get comfortable in the chaos. God has given us a strategy. God has given us a plan. Jesus Christ. Through Jesus Christ, we have assured victory. Through the blood of the Lamb that covers us, we are protected. We are covered. Not only us, our kids are. But whose report are you going to believe? Are you going to believe God? Are you going to believe what's going on around you? Are you going to believe what you see? Are you going to believe what you hear on the news? Are you going to believe what you see? Everybody in the mask? My life is in danger? Whose report are you going to believe? I'm going to believe God's report. You got to know no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Corona is a weapon. Your house, God. It ain't operating in faith. Unbelief is a weapon that the enemy is forming. Doubt is a weapon that the enemy is forming. We got to take a stand. We got to rise up. We got to take a stand for the things of God. We got to speak those things that be not as though they were. I see what's going on in my house. I see some craziness going on, but I ain't speaking to crazy God. I'm speaking, hallelujah, that God is going to heal my family. He's going to heal their mind. That my kids are going to get saved. They're going to know how to act. They're not going to be governed by the things of this land, by the things of this world. But they're going to be governed by God. They're going to be governed by the Holy Spirit. Whose report are you going to believe? Don't you know whatever report you're going to believe, that's what you're going to rise up to? Because that's what you bought into. There was a war going on back then, and there's a war going on back. There's a war going on now. Are you ready? Are you ready? We know the battle's already won, but are you ready to fight? Are you ready to use your sword, the word of God? Are you ready to use your faith? Are you ready to believe? The just shall live by faith. There might be injustices all around, but the just shall live by faith. Faith ain't what I just speak. Faith is what I believe. Faith is what I act on. I call those things that be not as though they are. As though they are. Hallelujah. Those crooked things that's manifesting around me. Those crooked things that's manifesting in my life. That's not of God. If your mind is confused, that's crooked. If you're addicted to drugs, that's crooked. If you're sleeping with somebody other than your own husband or wife, that's crooked. If you're having sex without marriage, that's crooked. It's crooked. Jesus Christ died so he could straighten the path. Why are we trying to walk a crooked path? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's a reason God's word is here. There's a reason God's word says what it says. There's a reason he said, be a virgin. Don't you have sex without marriage? That's a sin. Just because other young people are doing that don't mean you got to do it. And that's for the young and the old. Just because other people do it, you don't have to do that. Rise up. Have a standard. Live the life of faith. Show people, show the sinner how to live a life of faith. God didn't call you to be like everybody else. God didn't call you to do what everybody else do. Live the life of faith. Rise up. Let the Holy Ghost convict your heart. Conviction is a good thing. Without conviction, we won't know we're doing something wrong. We won't know that our thoughts are crooked. We won't know that what I'm doing now is crooked. Conviction is a good thing. Stir up my heart, Lord. Let me not be content in doing wrong. Let me not be content in bringing shame to your name. Let me not be content in glorifying the enemy. I won't be content in those things. I won't do those things. Have a standard. God loves us so that he puts restrictions. He put limitations. He put barriers. That's what his words are, because he loves us so. He does not want us to hurt ourselves. Having sex and you're not married, you're hurting yourself. You don't even know that, because your mind ain't mature enough. You don't even realize that. There's so many other things out there that could kill you. Just because a careless, irresponsible decision was made. But the ramifications of it can affect your life for eternity, can change your life. His word is here because he loves us unconditionally. His word is here because his word leads us, his word guides us. It lets us know the mind of God. But the Holy Spirit also lets us know the mind and the spirit of God. And if it bothers God and you say you're saved and Holy Ghost filled, it should bother you too. If it doesn't, something is wrong. Rise up. We don't have to rely on the wisdom of the world. God's wisdom is right before us. All we got to do is ask him. All we got to do is seek him with our whole heart. See, sometimes we ask, but we ask in a mess. We ain't asking with our whole heart. We keep some of it back. But we want God to come through for us. But we giving God pieces. But we expect him to give us the whole. Come on, y'all. It don't work like that. If we want the whole, we got to give God the whole. There's a war going on in the spiritual realm. And surely enough, it's manifested here. If we put on our spiritual eyeglasses, if we see in the spirit, it's manifested here. And I ain't speaking fear. I ain't speaking doubt. I'm not pessimistic. But y'all, this corona thing, it's just the beginning. Because Jesus is coming soon. And this and more things gotta happen before he comes. So don't be in dismay. Don't be shocked. Don't let what you see going on in this earthly realm move you or cause you to stagger, cause you to doubt, cause you to walk in unbelief. The Bible already said this is going to happen. But it's the testing of your faith. God knows what's in you, but he got to reveal it to you. Because sometimes we don't know how strong we are until we go through something. Sometimes we don't know how weak we are until we go through something. But in all that is working for our good. If you keep on believing, it's working for your good. Because God is turning things around. He is turning it around and working it in your favor. But don't you know you got to believe it? And you got to want it. Seek him. Seek his wisdom. Seek his wisdom. We got to let his mind be in us. The mind that was in Christ Jesus, hey, it can also dwell in us. Because the word says so. So God gave them a strategy. God has given us a strategy. He's given us a strategy. And it doesn't matter what we're going through. Lord, I don't want to go through it without you, God. Because I'm going to be defeated. If I go through without you, that's why it's so important. You got to study your word. Study your word. Get into his presence. You pray and you fast. It's too late during wartime. You got to do it now. See, y'all looking at the government saying, the government put us on quarantine. The government doing this or that. God did it. God put us on quarantine. Because if not, we'll still be out there busy doing, going, running around like a chicken with our head cut off, trying to get this done, trying to get that done, thinking it's in our power. And God is showing us we don't have any power. Anything you do is because he lets you do it. Whatever you have is because he released it to you. We don't have no power. We don't have no possession. It's all his. Whether you know it or not, whether you want to believe it or not, it all belongs to God. He had to quarantine us. He had to slow us down to get us in our houses, not only to spend time with our family, but to spend time you, did any of you, your prayer life, did it increase? Your fast, did it increase? Your time with God, did it increase? He didn't just keep you indoors. He didn't just separate you just to be doing that. It was for his purpose. Now he's preparing us. He's preparing his people at this hour. It's war time. Stop looking with your natural eye. Look with your spiritual eye. Get in tune with the Holy Spirit. Get into the spiritual realm. Lord, reveal to me what's going on. Show me what's going on. Pray to Lord, I don't understand. Lord, I don't understand why I'm confused sometimes. Lord, I don't understand why I'm depressed sometimes. Lord, I don't understand why I don't want to love sometimes. Lord, I don't understand. Lord, show me. Heal me, God. Let me walk in the healing, in your healing. Let me walk in your integrity, Lord. Help me to be real before you. Because if I'm real before you, I'll be real before people. There won't be no imitations. There won't be no pretense. It's war time. It's war time. See, back here in the Old Testament, they really went to physical war. Right now, it's spiritual for us. Don't fool yourself. It's a spiritual war going on. Ephesians says, put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Put on the whole armor of God. This army that the Israelites were going against, they had chariots of iron. They knew the importance of protecting their delicate parts. Those chariots of iron, they were like, have you ever seen armored vehicles in the military vehicles that are armored, that has metal or iron all around it protecting it? That's what the children of Israel, that's what the army was coming against. But don't you know, although this other army had those chariots of iron, they had more people. They did not defeat the army of God. Because God was with them. God was before them. I'm just going to read verse 14 to you. And Deborah said to Barak, up, for this is the day in which the Lord hath delivered Sisera into thine hand. Is not the Lord going out before thee? This is the day. Is not the Lord going out before thee? So Barak went down from Mount Tabor, and then and 10,000 men after him. Up, for this is the day in which the Lord had delivered Sisera into thine hand. Rise to your feet. Rise to your feet. God is saying, up, this is the day. Whatever that thing was that was trying to overtake you, whatever that thing was that was trying to take you out, whatever that thing was that was trying to kill you, up! Rise up! We are too passive. Well, we're supposed to be fighting. Well, we're supposed to be talking big and bad. We're passive. We're quiet. Rise up! Tell the devil, you're not going to have my house. You're not going to have my family. You're not going to have my kids. You're not going to have the things God has blessed me with. I won't be in debt to a lender. I will be free. My body is free. My mind is free. Rise up! Through the blood of Jesus Christ, we have victory. It has already been delivered. Not only did he die for you, he arose on the third day. And he's sitting at the right hand of the Father. Rise up! Rise up! Stop taking the mess of the enemy. This is war time! This is war time! Don't accept what the enemy is dishing out to you. Don't accept it. While he's speaking death, you speak life. When he says you're not gonna be the, you tell him, yes, I am. I'm not gonna be a doubter. I'm not gonna be a worrier. I am confident in the Lord. I'm not confident in myself. I am confident in the Lord. I am confident that he's gonna make a way. As I'm studying this book, when she went to the palm trees, she took God there. When she went to a house, she took God there. And when she went to the market, she took God there. Wherever she went, guess who went with her? God went with her. Because she knew God was with her. That's why we gotta pray. That's why we gotta know that we know I am a child of God. Thoughts. I'm thinking demonic thoughts. Because God is going to turn that thing around. You know what? He's going to turn that thing around. Everything that God does in our life, God don't waste nothing. Everything he does in our life, y'all. When we just call out to him and cry out to him, he is just. He will answer us. And instead of the devil having his foot on your neck, guess what? He's going to be below your feet. He's going to be under your feet. Because you're not relying on your own strength. You're relying on the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. I thank God for his word. We have victory. Don't get comfortable, y'all. This is for a time. Know that God is with you. Speak what he wants you to speak. Say what he wants you to say. When you're doing, when you're walking in obedience to God, it's not always easy. God will ask us to do the hard things. Because those demons out there are real. And they're not playing. So God will tell us to call out things. Call out things. Because if it's wrong, it's wrong. Don't minimize what he's doing in your life. It may look right now that it's all for nothing. But you just keep your focus on our God. And then you will see that this is just a part of his plan. It looks like it's going to bring about death, but it's going to bring about eternal life. It looks like Jesus is going to be dead, dead, dead. It looks like the cross is going to be the end. But it didn't end that way. And because it didn't end that way, he still has love. And because he has love, we got life. And his spirit dwells in us. So Father God, we thank you for your word, Jesus. Lord, we thank you right now. This is for a time, God. And Lord, you got a strategy, you got a plan, God. Oh God, you're shaking up this earth. In the spiritual realm, oh God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Preparation has went on, God. And it's manifested on this earthly realm, God. You're calling your warriors to rise up, God. You're calling us, oh God, to not conform to the things of this world, God. But to be transformed in your word by the renewing of our minds, God. For those things, God, those crooked places in our lives, oh God, we cast it on the altar right now, God. We offer it to you, God. We don't want it. We don't need it, God. Because when we give that to you, God, then you will make those crooked paths straight, God. Only you can do it, oh God. All those things that try to influence us, it will not fulfill, oh God. But we thank you, God, that your word is life, that your word is hope, that your word is the sure foundation, God. Lord, I ask right now that you have your way, God, to the people, God, that opened their hearts and heard your word. That your word have stirred something in them, oh God. Stirred up something in them, oh God. Father God, right now I ask and I thank you for how you're pouring into them, oh God. For how you're strengthening them, oh God. For that thing that used to cause weakness, God, is no longer there. But God, you are giving them strength, God. Strengthen their inward parts, oh God. Let them not be afraid. Let them not stagger at the promise, God. Sometimes we wonder how you're going to do it, God. But it's not for us to want. It is not for us to stagger and back up because of unbelief, God. But to stand firm in your word, God. To trust you, God. To know that you have it covered, oh God. Father God, I thank you right now, God. That we surrender those high places in our life, God. Those places of idolatry, God. Those things, God. above those things that we may have yielded to, God, that was not your will for our life, God. God, we place it on the altar right now, God. We place it on the altar. We give it to you, Lord. Because, Lord, we got victory in you, God. And we say thank you, Lord, for your victory, God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. That the battle's already won. And the fight is already fixed.
Lord.
But God, that we continue steadfast in you, in your word, God. Moving, God, from faith to faith. To glory to glory, God. In you, God. Lord, we thank you right now, Jesus. We raise our hand in praise, God. We raise our hands in worship. Because although God, you confounded that army, God, you caused the army of Sisera to be confused. They didn't know what was going on. And then the Israelite army got after Sisera's army. And Israel army prevailed. And although Sisera thought, because he got off his horse and he started to run, and he went to a friend's house. But see, God, the enemy thinks, hallelujah, that there's a loophole in your plan. The enemy thinks that he has opportunity. Although it looks like he's winning, he's not going to win, because there was another woman of God, Jehel. That invited Sisera into her home. And she got a peg and a hammer. And that Sisera rest and went to sleep. She hit him in the head with the hammer. And the peg killed him. So though the enemy thinks, oh God, that there's a loophole in your plan, there is not. Because the victory belongs to you, Jesus. All we got to do is put our faith, put our hope in you, God. And because Israel had victory, Deborah and Barak, they wrote a praise song in chapter 5. God tells us we got the victory. And because we know we got the victory, it don't matter what comes our way, God. We can praise you. We can worship you, God. Because we lean out to our own understanding. But we lean into you, God. Blessed assurance. Lord, cover the minds and the hearts of your people, God. Do it this time. Do it this hour, Lord. Let them know you got it worked out and that you will always prevail. We thank you right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's believe.